lesions that use a probe in order to clean samples. One take drills beneath the surface of the bone with a little borehole to remove, to try to get beyond where it might have been contaminated by archaeologists or people who sampled the bone. The chain is a bit of powder. That powder is demineralized and the proteins are removed through a series of chemical steps and then turned into sequenceable forms and sequenced on one of the modern sequencers to produce a lot of data. So that's the basic steps that are used to get into DNA on samples. And there's a whole bunch of optimizations that have been implemented in order to make this more efficient and really have increased the amount of DNA that one can get out of a sample by literally 10,000 times over the last approximately 6 years. So I'm just going to start with a picture of Moore's Law. So Moore's Law is about computer worlds, and it's where the number of elements on integrated circuits doubles every 1 to 2 years, and that's been going on for the last century, and it's driven the computer revolution. So there's a Moore's Law of ancient DNA, but the rise has been much faster and it's been much more recent. So in 2010, and I'm telling you here about whole genome data, not just mitochondrial DNA sequences, but just whole genome data where there's enough data to really learn about population variation. So if you use as a cutoff in an amount where you can begin to learn about population relationships, there were 4 sequences published in 2010, there were a burst of 20 or 30 sequences published in 2014, and then it went into hyperdrive in 2015 with several hundred sequences, and it's increasing and increasing. Now we have more than 1,000 sequences in our laboratory, and I'm sure that's true also of other laboratories, and there's so much data being produced right now that there's much more data that's unpublished and unpublished than published just because there's not enough time to publish it. So what we've done in our laboratory, I guess it's a very American thing to do, is to make these beautiful techniques developed in Europe, beautiful peace force techniques, to make them industrial. And so we try to take the old approach, which is still a wonderful approach, of searching for a golden sample, screening and screening and screening these skeletal remains for some sample that will have enough DNA that can be sequenced and then working very hard on it, to a process where we screen many, many samples and take advantage of efficiencies and techniques that make it possible to convert a higher fraction of samples to working genome-wide data that provide the information we need. So our goal was to implement a screening process that we turn a large fraction of the samples we analyze into working data and to have a reasonable cost per sample to produce genome-wide data, in our case less than $500 a sample. One of the reasons ancient DNA is so expensive and continues to be so expensive in most implementations is that because so little ancient DNA is human. Clones are mostly, the DNA you get out of clones is mostly microbial. It's from the bacteria and fungi that were at you when you died. And so very little of the DNA that you sequence is from the individual you want to sequence, even if it's an uncontaminated sample. Beyond that, of course, most of the DNA that you sequence, even from a human, is not from the sections of the genome you're probably going to want to analyze, perhaps reasons that are of interest for adaptation or for studying population relationships. So the solution that we took was a solution which is an adaptation of a method developed in Leipzig by Xiaomei Fu and Matthias Meyer. And what we did is we adapted this to a set of more than 1 million positions in the genome. And what we do is we take the DNA sample, made into sequenceable form, a DNA sequencing library, and we take a technique that's used really in exome sequencing. We watch it over a series of plate sequences, typically 50 DNA letter-long sequences that target the positions of the genome we're interested in, and what's left is mostly sequences that are from humans, and not only from humans, but from the regions we're interested in. So most of what we're left with is human from the regions we're interested in, and then it's not a lot of sequencing to obtain data from these approximately 1 million positions in the genome. So we're currently screening and screening more than 1,000 samples per year in our laboratory, which is a huge change compared to the situation in the past. We're not the only laboratory that's able to screen substantial numbers of samples, but it's really transformative in terms of what it allows us to do. So this allows us to reduce costs and to improve quality. So here's a really wonderful sample that was published last year by a group in Denmark, which took about 100 samples and sequenced them brute force by just running the samples through the sequencer. This is the number of sequences in hundreds of thousands, and approximately the same as cost in dollars. And this was a $1 million experiment where, on average, about 20% of positions in the genome were covered. But when we apply this approach, we have many fewer sequences required and higher average coverage of the positions that we think are most interesting to analyze. And so it allows the great amounts of efficiency and makes it economical to do this kind of work. So I'm going to tell you in the second part of my talk about a specific example about how ancient DNA has provided new insights about the past. And I'm going to talk about Europe and about Western Eurasia more broadly, not because these are particularly important places of the world, but it's because where we know the most. So this technology of ancient DNA was invented in Europe. The skeletal remains from Europe are the ones that have been surveyed first. And because of that, we have much more data. About 90% of the genome-wide data in literature is from Europe or from Western Eurasia. And just as interesting things can be done in the Americas and East Asia, in South Asia and Africa. But I'm going to tell you about Europe to illustrate the power of these approaches. So the background for this is just about to start with present-day data, and I want to frame this in the following way. So West Eurasia, West Eurasians, by which I mean a region that extends from Europe, on the Atlantic coast of Europe, all the way to Iran, into Central Asia, in the middle of Asia, are genetically much of a muchness. They're genetically very similar. So if you measure the square of the frequency difference, that genetic variance between people across the whole region, it's not very different. And this is actually what gave rise in the 18th century to the scientific classifications of people into different groups, the sort of observation that people are genetically broadly similar at some gross level across this region. And if you look at some genetic variants, you can see this. So this is a pie chart of the frequency of variants that some people have one type and some people have another type. These are very unusual variants that are very different in frequency across populations. But you see West Eurasia clustering here with all these red dots over here. And in East Asians, from all the way from Korea to Indonesia, again, there's genetic high similarity and then a big sharp division moving into Western Eurasia. And in much of Africa, but not all of Africa, again, a lot of similarity. And the question is, how did this homogeneity across these regions arise? I think people, centuries ago, when people first began trying to make these categories, thought these are age-old things. These have existed for 40,000 years, or for tens of thousands of years since populations separated from each other, or even longer, maybe it always existed. And in fact, the answer is, these are only 5,000 years old, these clusters that we see today. And from ancient DNA, we know this, and I'm going to tell you how we know this from the ancient Europe. So I'm going to first tell you about Europe specifically, and I'm going to tell you how Europeans today are the result of massive mixture of three highly different populations that are different from each other as European and East Asian. It all happened in the last 9,000 years. So I'm just going to first introduce a few pieces of evidence from outside genetics, the evidence of archaeology and the evidence of language. So what you need to know about the archaeology of Europe, there's many things, but one very important thing is the arrival of farming in Europe. So farming was not invented in Europe, it was invented in the Near East, beginning between 12,000 and 11,000 years ago, probably in present-day Turkey or Syria, and for Iraq, and it spread from there, reaching Greece, present-day Greece, about 3,000 years later, and then it reached Britain and Scandinavia by about 6,000 years ago. It spread across Europe very dramatically, population densities increased, lifestyle has completely changed, the types of food people ate completely changed. This is a dramatic change. The question has always been whether this massive transformation economically was accompanied by movements of people. There was a lot of skepticism that there might be such big movements of people, but there was always a question about whether it was movements of people or just adaption of ideas. I mean, we all use cell phones right now, but we're not all ethnically, genetically the same, and we adapt ideas from other people, so maybe farming was adopted by people's neighbors, or did it spread through people. The other observation is languages. So people in Europe today, almost all with exceptions like Basque and Hungarian and Estonian and Finnish, speak languages that are closely related to each other and related also to the languages of northern India, of Iran and Armenia, called the European languages, with a great gap in between in the Near East, and we know it's been a gap where Indo-European languages have barely been spoken for the last 5,000 years, because writing was invented in the Near East, and we know for the last 5,000 years that except for Turkey, present-day Turkey, sometimes there haven't been these languages in this region. So what has this caused quantum movements of people? So in 2009, and then with genome-wide data in 2012, it became absolutely clear from genome-wide data that the arrival of farmers in Europe was accompanied by huge movements of people. And the way this was known is that people successfully got mitochondrial DNA. This is the DNA in these energy factories of your cell. It's about 15,000 DNA letters long. It's only about 200,000 of the total length of the genome, but it was the part of the DNA that first people began to study with ancient DNA, because there's about 1,000 times more copy per cell, and the challenge in DNA is to get anything at all from these drones, and so people started with what there was the most of. So when people study DNA sequences from hunter-gatherers from Europe from 8,000 years or 9,000 or 10,000 years ago, what they found was all of the mitochondrial sequences were, most great majority were of two types, what they called U4 and U5, defined by mutations characteristic of those types. But the first farmers had almost no U4 and U5, clearly evidence of people coming in from elsewhere. Genome-wide data from people from 5,000 years ago in Sweden, which was substantially after the first arrival of farming, led by Pontus Stoglund and colleagues, then showed that, already 5,000 years ago, the first farmers of northern Europe and Scandinavia were genetically very different from hunter-gatherers who were living side by side with them at the same time. Again, that was different from each other as Americans and East Asians, and that, in fact, were genetically very similar, not the present-day people from Sweden, but the present-day people from Sardinia. And they had a model where people in Europe today are a mixture of two ancestral populations, the farmers who have left the most ancestry in people today in Sardinia, and the hunter-gatherers who have left the most ancestry in people today in northwestern and northeastern and northern Europe, and that people today are a mixture of these two sources. So that was the model. So in 2012, we had in our laboratory another observation, which was hard to reconcile with this model, and it was this. So what we found is we developed a statistical test, which we call a three-population test. And what we do is we take genetic data, variation data. So what we're looking at is hundreds of thousands of positions in the genome, single nucleotide polymorphisms, where some people have one type, say an adenine, and some people have another type, say a thymine, and we can score individuals for whether they have an adenine or a cytosine or adenine and a thymine or something like this. And so what we did is we take a set of three populations, a test population that we're testing to see whether it's mixed, and then two possible source populations. And if the test population is mixed, of lineages that are related sometime in the past to the source populations, the prediction is that the frequencies of these genetic variants in the test population will tend to be intermediate between the two source populations. So it's mixed. So the frequencies will tend to be intermediate. So we can test this, so the frequencies tend to be intermediate. At any one position, we can't measure that with any reliability, but at the average of hundreds of thousands of positions, we can obtain a very precise determination of whether the frequencies are on average intermediate in the test population relative to the source population. So we have this test in hand, and we ran this test on about 50 worldwide populations, present-day ones, and we looked for whether each population had evidence of mixture from any pair of the other two. So we ran our computer in a loop over the data, and what we found is that in northern Europeans, for example, present-day French people, there's a huge signal of mixture. One of them, the mixed of source population, is from the most ancestry in Sardinia, for example, and the other was not Northern Europeans, but it was Native Americans. So this was a really weird observation, and it definitely was Native Americans, it was not Siberians, it was not South Asians, it was not East Asians, Native Americans gave a much stronger signal. And what we proposed is that what was actually going on is that there was in Northern Eurasia, at some point in the past, more than 15,000 years ago, what we call a ghost population, a major population that lived in Northern Eurasia in the past, more than 15,000 years ago, and contributed some of the ancestry of Native Americans living today, and then sometime later also contributed ancestry to Europeans. So this population doesn't exist in unexplored anymore, it's been largely displaced since, explaining why people in Siberia today are not as good a source for European mixture as our Native Americans, but this population existed in the past. So we call the population of ancient North Eurasians, and we think that they've contributed ancestors to the Americas and also to Northern Europeans. So that was the proposal of a ghost population statistically reconstructed based on present-day populations, no data from it. So what was very exciting to us was at the end of the next year, this ghost was found by a group, an ancient DNA group working in Denmark, led by Eske Willerslev, and what they did is they sequenced DNA from a 24,000-year-old individual, a boy, from the Lake Baikal region of East Central Siberia. This individual was more closely related to Europeans even than Native Americans are, and was clearly the correct source population for the ancestry both in the Americas and in Europe. Today, the dark blue in the heat map shows that there's not much ancestry like that anymore, reflecting the fact that most of the indigenous people of Siberia today are the result of migrations that have brought people into this region from elsewhere more closely related to East Asians than the people were in Lake Baikal at that time. So this is very exciting to us that we could see the echoes of the ghost population written in genetic data from present-day people, and that you could predict ancient DNA. But once the ancient DNA was in hand, everything became much more clear, because it's much easier to look at it directly than to study it indirectly. So what we did, and what we worked led by Joseph Lazaridis, working with Johannes Krause, and then at the University of Tübingen, was to obtain high-quality data in 2014 from an early farmer from Europe about 7,000 years ago, and a hunter-gatherer who lived about 8,000 years ago in Europe, and then to compare it to this ancient genome generated by the Danish group, and to try to build a model of population relationships. So I'm going to now digress for 2 minutes to try to tell you about how we look at our genetic data. So this is data from 777 present-day individuals from West Eurasia. So West Eurasia refers to this group of people who are genetically pretty similar to each other, including Europeans and Central Asians and the Near Easterners. And people, it's also colored by which population individuals are from, the self-identified ancestry, although the self-identified ancestry is not used in the mathematical technique used to display these points. So the nature of the data we have is single nucleotide polymorphism genotype array data. What this means is that we or others have looked at we have taken a genotyping shift which interrogates each individual at about 600,000 positions in the genome and scores that individual for what they have, adenine, cytosine, for example. So at each position, they will have 0, 1, or 2 copies of the mutation that chimpanzee doesn't have, for example. And there are about 600,000 rows corresponding to each of these positions, and then 777 columns corresponding to each of the individuals. We then multiply the matrix by itself and see how close each individual is to each other individual, and that's a measure of genetic similarity of all of these individuals. And then we run principal component analysis on that, and that separates the samples according to the most efficient way of separating them. So for example, the first principal component might be 0.3 times the value at position 1, minus 0.2 times the value at position 2, plus 0.4 times the value at position 3, and the principal component 2 might be some other combination. And the mathematics of principal component analysis will efficiently separate samples in this way. So when we run this on present-day West Eurasians, we see a really dramatic pattern of two parallel gradients. All Europeans, almost without exception, fall in this gradient, with Sardinians at the bottom end and Northeast Europeans at the other end, and different forms intermediate. And Near Easterners, almost without exception, follow this gradient, with Armenians and people from the north of the Near East here, people from the south of the Near East, like Bedouins and Arabians, over down here. So there are very few intermediate populations. The populations that are intermediate are populations with known or possibly known relatively recent contacts between the Near East and Europe, for example, Greece or the islands of the Mediterranean, or Jewish populations. So what we did is we tried to look at the data and find a model of history based on genetic frequency similarity that is consistent with the data through the lens of our resolution, and I'm not going to describe the statistical tests used to determine that this model was consistent with the data, but we were able to show that this model was consistent with the data as far as we could tell. So we started with these ancient samples, this 24,000-year-old ancient North Eurasian and this 8,000-year-old hunter-gatherer, and we found that they were consistent with descending from a common ancestral population since separating earlier from East Asians and more distantly from Sub-Saharan Africans. So far, so good. Native Americans are a mixture of the ancient North Eurasians. As I said before, they contributed to Native Americans, but they're not all the ancestry. They also have ancestry from East Asians. And this was the main finding of that paper by this Danish group, that Native Americans today seem to be consistent with deriving from a very ancient mixture of two groups, one these ancient North Eurasians and another East Asians. There's also an idea that Native Americans and East Asians are somehow sister groups that descend more distantly from West Eurasians, but in fact, that's not true. It's more complicated, and this is a potential resolution of that. The first farmers of Europe are a mixture of an ancient group related to the hunter-gatherers of Europe and another very distinct population that's actually a new ghost population we predict from the data. We call them the basal Eurasians, and we've gotten closer to finding them now. We haven't quite found them in terms of ancient DNA. It's a very interesting lineage because it's separated from the ancestors of West Eurasians and East Eurasians before they separated from each other. And people in Europe today can only be borrowed to have a mixture from all three of these sources. So we have a three-way mixture, not a two-way mixture. So the mixture proportions vary depending on which West European population they are, but almost everybody has ancestry from all three sources, from the hunter-gatherers, from the farmers, and from the ancient North Eurasians. So what actually happened is the ancient DNA has shown that the farmers coming to Europe displaced the hunter-gatherers, or mixed with them. But all the ancient DNA that's been studied up to this time only showed farmer and hunter-gatherer ancestry. But today, Europeans all have this ancient North Eurasian ancestry. So something must have happened to bring this ancient North Eurasian ancestry in. So that was the next thing we did. We tried to actually find when the ancient North Eurasian ancestry entered Europe. And so the way we started this is in a paper based on mitochondrial DNA ancient sequences, which looked at DNA from about 300 mitochondrial sequences from 9 successive archaeological cultures defined based on their pottery, dating from about 7,500 years ago to about 3,500 years ago. And they start with the first farmers, or even hunter-gatherers, and continue until the early Bronze Age, when people start using new metals much more widely in Europe. So what we virus is attached to continuity, it's possible that this population, the second population, is consistent with descending directly from the first without subsequent mixture and so on. And so we had a grid where we test for continuity between each of these successive populations, the hunter-gatherers, the first farmers, slightly lighter farmers, and so on. And there's a colored box here, and there's significant evidence of difference. When we see a line of very dark colored boxes showing that the hunter-gatherers are discontinuous with all the subsequent farmer populations, this is again the evidence of hunter-gatherers replacing the farmers replacing hunter-gatherers. It's very dramatic. But after the first farmers arrived, about 7,500 years ago in this part of Europe, there's continuity for the next 2,500 to 3,000 years. There's no very strong evidence of new major input. But then bang, 4,500 years ago, there's discontinuity again. It's beginning with a culture called the Cordillera culture, and ever afterward, there's discontinuity with the previous line. So this is a hint of what happened. The way we explored this further is we collected genome-wide data on a large subset of the same individuals, plus additional individuals, many of them from Central Europe, from Germany, many of them from Spain, and a whole important series of samples from the Samara region of Lessa, which is far eastern Europe, and it dates to just before the Cordillera area. So now I'm going to actually give you a sort of still movie of what happens over time in Europe. This is the same picture I showed you before, principal components analysis. Remember, here's the Near East, here's Europe. I'm now going to lay out these dots so that you can focus on the ancient samples. So here's the Near East, here's Europe. And the question is, how do the ancient samples fall relative to present-day populations over time? So if you look at the hunter-gatherers of Europe before farmers arrived, hunter-gatherers fall beyond Europe in the direction of European differentiation from the Near East. What this is saying is that all of these hunter-gatherers from Sweden here, from Western Europe here, in Spain, and Luxembourg, are from a population that doesn't exist in Europe in unmixed form before, anymore, but that Europeans today have ancestry from them, because they are moved and shifted in that direction relative to the Near East, which you can actually show formally using genomic analysis. In the north, in the far east of Europe, you actually have populations like this on the European, on the East Eurasian, on the West Eurasian steppe, which we call Eastern hunter-gatherers, which are pointing at the high end of this gradient, similar to that ancient North Eurasian, and we think they carry their later population that carry this ancestry. And so Europeans today are arrayed on a gradient with different proximity to these ancient North Eurasians. So you can see both gradients represented here, the hunter-gatherers responsible for this shift, and the ancient North Eurasians represented for this gradient, all this gradient. So now comes the first farmers, and there's a large cluster of samples we have here from all over Europe that are similar genetically to present-day Sardinians, as we knew already, but present-day Europeans, except for Sardinians, positioned at a place that is not yet represented by any ancient samples. At the same time, what happens after that is when slightly later farmers shift slightly toward the hunter-gatherers. What's happening here is that the farmers who initially arrived were socially segregated from hunter-gatherers, but over the next 2,000 years, they began to mix with them. So those social barriers broke down. We can see that happening in Spain, and we can see that happening in Sweden, and we can see that happening in Germany and Hungary. It's very exciting to see this happening in parallel everywhere. The simultaneous with this in far eastern Europe, another mixture occurs. These eastern hunter-gatherers mix with people from the northern Near East, from places like Armenia or Iran, and form a mixed population here, analogous to these mixed populations. But at that time, 5,000 years ago, you still don't have populations like British people today, like Northeast Europeans, even like most southern Europeans. So when does that happen? Well, it happens 3,500 years ago with the Cordillera and succession groups, succeeding groups. Suddenly, these groups like this and this mix together, and you can show using formal statistical techniques that it's very difficult to get this mixture to happen without groups very closely related to these and very closely related to these. These people are what are called They are steppe pastoralists. They're herding sheep on the steppe. They took their sheep out onto the steppe for the first time after beginning to use wheeled vehicles, carts and wheels and horses, which allowed them to move out in mobile homes onto the steppe. And they took advantage of this landscape, which was unexploited before, and expanded very dramatically. There's been controversy about how they affected Europe, and what the genetic data tells is that they actually had a major genetic impact on Europe at this time. So, just summarizing, the population changes after the advent of agriculture in Europe. 7,500 years ago, the first farmers land in the Balkans of Greece, coming from an alternate origin in the Near East. We have ancient DNA now from Turkey, and it's a good match to that, which matches a lot of archaeological hypotheses about where they came from. And if you measure the proportion of Near Eastern ancestry in farmers at this time, it's approximately 100% measured by this orange, the farmer ancestry. In the next 2,000 years, the farmers and the hunter-gatherers mix, as I mentioned before, as these social barriers break down, but there's still no ancestry related to the steppe, and that's ubiquitous in Europe today. The next thing that happens 3,500 years ago, the populations appear that are more than half steppe ancestry related to these yamnaya, and they come from the steppe. And people in Europe today, especially Northern Europeans, have at least half ancestry. In many European populations, this is now the dominant ancestry contribution to Europeans. And you may ask, suppose that the ancient North Eurasians are only a quarter or eighth of the ancestry of present-day Europeans, but now the Yamnaya are a much larger proportion. What's going on is the ancient North Europeans and Eurasians are tracer by. They actually weren't the whole ancestry of the Yamnaya. The Yamnaya only had perhaps a quarter of ancestry from this population, and so they put a minimum of the proportion of ancestry coming from the East. So the Yamnaya actually brought a larger proportion of ancestry in, and this is actually probably the single most important contributor, or along with early farmers to Europeans today, these people. This is not only our work, another group publishing at the same time as this Danish group that I mentioned before, and published a parallel paper and came to similar conclusions based on their independent data set of the dramatic turnover in Europe at this time related to the Yamnaya. So now I'm going to expand a little bit more broadly in West Eurasia and talk about the broader West Eurasian context of what happened in Europe. So Europe is a peninsula of Eurasia, which is an interesting place, but it's a broader part of this broad region where today genetically people are very similar. But as I mentioned at the beginning, people in West Eurasia today are genetically strikingly similar. So what did it always that way? So we just published a paper a couple of months ago where we got DNA from 44 ancient samples from the ancient Near East, ranging from 14,000 years ago to 4,000 years ago, from Iran, from Israel and Jordan, from Armenia, and they include people from before the transition. transition to farming, from just after the transition to farming. They include people from the east of the region, and they include people from the west of the region, and they include people moving into the Middle Ages, into the Copper Ages, the Bronze Age, over this period. So I'm going to just digress a little bit, and what made this ancient DNA work in the Near East possible, and I think what's going to make work in Africa and South Asia possible too, is this innervation of the pectoral bone. So the pectoral bone is a piece of your temporal bone, it's the part of your temporal bone that is around the inner ear region, and it has been realized in the last year or so, it's a year or two, that the pectoral bone contains about 100 times higher density of DNA in skeletal remains than any other part of the body that people have looked at, any part of the skeleton that people have looked at. And so ancient DNA scientists have moved toward preferentially trying to sample from the pectoral bone where possible, because it's so much richer a source of DNA than any other part of the skeleton people have identified. And that, combined with this enrichment technique I mentioned, has increased success rates a lot. The Middle East was a very difficult place for ancient DNA because heat is bad for DNA preservation. And so, but using the pectoral bone and enrichment, we have been able to get working DNA, and others also had successes in other really exciting contexts. So what we do is we take these pectoral bones, use a dental sandblaster to remove the part of the pectoral bone containing the cochlea, which is the part of the that contains the a lot of the apparatus of hearing. Here's an isolated cochlea. We grind and we mill it. In a miller, we obtain powder, and then we subject that to the later stages of ancient DNA collection. So here's our updated version of the picture I gave you before, but now with more samples, and there was not samples here before because we now have ancient samples from the Near East across this whole gradient. People at the bottom of the gradient and people at the top of the gradient. And what we find is that ancient Iranians are at the top of the gradient, and ancient people from the southern Levant, from Israel and Jordan, are at the bottom of the gradient. So they too have different proportions of ancestry. And in fact, if you measure the level of differentiation between the different groups in West Eurasia,